Session of 30 minutes. We will be now talking about those magnificent women and their flying machines, ISRO's mission to Mars, with Mrs. Minnie Vaid. Mrs. Minnie Vaid has juggled multiple roles over the 3-decade stint in mainstream media. She is a print and television journalist, a documentary filmmaker, creative producer for feature films, and more recently, author of 3 non-fictional books. A Doctor to Defend the Binayak Saint Story 2011, Iron Oak, Two Journeys 2013, and The End in the Year of Elephant 2016. Her area of interest includes social and political issues in rural India, human rights, and environment and gender. Mrs. Barkha Mathur is a senior journalist working for English dailies in city for over 2 decades. Being a feature editor for TOI, she has covered a large segment of subject which includes trends, lifestyles, art, music, and culture. She will be moderating this session for us. Over to you.
Hello. Anyway, let's just go ahead. I'm very happy to be here, and I'm very happy to see a nice young audience, because that is the target audience for my book, and this is the book. Thank you, Barkha. Okay, so the main thing is, why was I interested? There was a conference of the IWN, which is the Indian Women's Network of CII. So mostly these are corporate events, and so I tend to shy away from them. But because the invitation mentioned 3 speakers of the Mangalyaan mission, the ISRO Women Scientists, that sparked my interest, so I went for it. And they spoke, the 3 women, Ritu Karidhal, Minal, and Moumita, Datta. All 3 worked on the Mangalyaan mission. And they held the audience, you know, sort of captive and spellbound for about 40 minutes. And if the lunch break hadn't been there, they would have just continued on. And I was so impressed by what they spoke, the way they said it, and you know that entire attitude of being very matter of fact about the work that they did. Yeah. So I went expecting people, you know, I mean the scientists will say, okay, so we did this great thing and you know, Mangalyaan mission and you know, instead they explained the mission in great detail and the jobs that they did, but they were very, very you know, sort of they weren't like, okay, it's a very big thing.
They just simplified the entire
thing. Yeah, they just simplified it, and they also said, yeah, so you know, we worked on the mission during the day, and then we worked in the night, and we looked after our children and our families, and we also sent a rocket to Mars. So it was just a very kind of, you know, matter of fact way that they took their work. And at the end of the day, it is the work that is really important. You know, I mean, it's the work that they do and the way that they did it. So after that session got over, and then after lunch break, I went to meet them, and I said, you know, I think there's a larger story here. So at heart, I'm a journalist. I've always remained a journalist. So that, you know, while they were talking, I said, okay, you know, people don't know these women. They don't know the work that they've done. They don't know the challenges that they faced in doing it. So let me, you know, sort of go and meet them for a larger story. And they said, they were actually very taken aback when I went, you want to do a book on us? Why? I mean, are you not aware of the enormity of the task that we've accomplished? So then they say, yeah, okay, so you have to go to the ISRO PR and all. And so that was a very long process, getting permissions, like in any government organization, for 4.5 months. And that, again, is another tenet of journalism that you is persistence. And you have to just keep trying and trying and trying and trying. And finally, after 4.5 months, I got permission. And then once I entered ISRO and started meeting them, then it was all smooth sailing.
So, what was the most challenging aspect that you discovered amongst these women, you know, taking up the project, etc.? What did you find the most challenging in the
Yeah, a couple of things. One is that, you know, I wanted to write a book which was written in simple language, and my target audience was actually people like you and young girls wanting to do STEM, people who don't know about science. So that was my main aim. So because, you know, as part of my research, I had read some of the books that people had already written on the Mars mission, not the women, but the main Mars mission. There was one book which is called Red Planet. It's about 720 pages. I defy anybody to read it and understand it. Even 2 pages, if you have understood, greater you than me, yeah, because I really couldn't. So I said, okay, I'm going to write this in a simple way. So that was difficult. Now, I quit maths and science in class 11, very happy. Because I suffered so bad. And my teachers are also very happy to help me out while I was coming in. And so after class 11, you can imagine, to go back and then learn about gamma ray bursts and trajectory and, you know, apogee and perigee and all these things which I really didn't know, that was challenging. Because they would say something and I would look blank, and then they said, okay, fine, so we simplify. So slingshot theory and all, for instance. Ritu Karidhal, who later on became the mission director for Chandrayaan. So she explained it really well, and you know, so that kind of opened, and that was one big challenge, to write it in that way. Because also some terms that they used, if I had to like look for gamma ray bursts, for instance, so I'd go and see that, and they'll say, okay, Hubble telescope, okay, what is Hubble telescope? So in and in, like a peeling of an onion, you keep going in and, you know, get that. So that was one. The second thing that was challenging, I mean, apart from the actual, you know, thing of getting permission and waiting and all of that, was lack of data. There is not enough data on women scientists. In fact, not scientists only, there is very little. But women scientists, it's like people don't even think that is important enough to collate information on how many women scientists occupy leadership roles. Not very many. But the data in the studies were like, you know, 2010. I was very happy the day I found a study, 2014. I was like, okay, at 2014 when I started writing the book, it was 2017, was 3 years old data, and I was still happy to get it because there was no data. And so that was a little, you know, that was a challenge. And then of course, as all writers, and you're a writer, you're also supposed to survive. While you're writing a book like this, it took from beginning to end till the day it was published 3 years. Yeah, and publishers will, you know, think that you should just survive on fresh air and water and the love of your family. And really, it was almost that. So yeah, these were the three main challenges.
So if we read the book, you know, what comes across is that these women scientists were balancing their, you know, very tough work that they were doing, and they were managing their homes, dropping kids to school. So how charming was that? You know, you brought it out very well in the book.
Yeah, see, so I went with a stereotypical notion of what a woman scientist would be. You know, kind of like a female Einstein with the fuzzy hair, and somebody who's always in the science lab and never wants to get out and is only working on the time, and you know, stuff like that. And the reality was totally opposite. These were women who were regular women, you know. And in fact, the first picture which went viral, if you will notice, though actually it was administrative staff, they weren't really women scientists, but still, pride in the same organization. Kanchanaram sarees, mugras in hair, and you know, like high fiving, a whole bunch of women and the men at the outskirts, you know, sort of just looking and smiling, you know. So that picture stayed in lots of people's heads. That was an iconic picture. So these women, they, and a lot of them came from very modest, conservative backgrounds. They've had like struggles with their parents. Even Ritu Karidhal lived in Lucknow, and she had to fight with her father. Said, no, even though she got into ISRO, but just to come from Lucknow to Bangalore, father took 1 week to decide. And finally, her mother said, no, she's talented, please let her go. And I'm so glad that they did. And then she became mission director for Chandrayaan. So they came from, yeah, so all of them had stories like this. Like Valanmati, for instance, just to give you an example, since we are mentioning it, is project director of RISAT-1, which is a very big thing. So her parents, and she came from a small village in Tamil Nadu, her parents had chopped out her whole life. Yeah? They said, so you finish your BSc here, and then, you know, if you want, you can do MSc, but otherwise you will get your job. And then, you know, we'll find you a boy somewhere nearby. And then, you know, if you settle down here only, then we look after your children also when they're born. And so we'll help you with babysitting. They chopped out her whole life. And she said, no, I don't want to do this. I want to go to, I think that was IIT Madras at that point, and I want to do my post-graduation. And she did it. And some, I don't know, maybe 20 years later or so, when she was project director for RISAT-1, then we
had the press and media going to her father's house and saying, so how did you feel when your daughter became a polyglot? And I hope he remembered that day, you know, that he told her, we'll just, you know, like, stay here and we'll do all this.
He should have said, I nearly didn't send her there.
Yeah, exactly, but he wouldn't have actually done that. But yes, yes, that was the thing. So they all had faced very, you know, sort of real kind of problems, and they want, you know, all fancy degrees and, you know, you don't have to be an IITian to reach ISRO'S, nothing of the sort. It was, they had a goal and they followed their goal, and the work that they did also kind of, you know, at the end of the day, it is the work.
So, but what you also realize about the gender biases, the gender inequality, the glass ceilings that the women are seeing, how much is it there in ISRO?
See, there are two answers to this question. One is a diplomatic answer, but I think that I'll be truthful because the reality is what. That is what the next generation should know. Inside ISRO, there isn't gender bias the way that you would, you know, expect, because a lot of the women still are getting the top position. Yeah, Mangalyaan mission, for instance, had about 40%. Women in good roles and not subordinate roles, good roles. Chandran 2 had a project director, Vanita, who's a lady, mission director, Ritu Karidhal. So if you, the message that they told me over several interviews, and I interviewed about, I think 21 women, not just the Mangalyaan women, 21 women in the book, ISRO Women Scientists, they all said the work speaks. Yeah. So we don't have a gender issue as such, because under our lab coats, we're all women. I mean, we're all scientists, so don't call us women scientists. It's actually very myth that people would call them women scientists. You know, we're scientists. So, having said that, where there's no obvious gender bias, but the biases come through in the fact that the numbers are very, very low. Yeah. So, if you take even the number of, like, first total number of women working in ISRO, less than 20%. Total number of women in technical and scientific areas in ISRO, 16%. Yeah. So this, I mean, and no woman has been center director in ISRO. No woman has become obviously chairman, chairperson ISRO. No such thing. So even in scientific academies, in fellowships, in awards, even in say Nobel Prize, you know, there are 17 women who've got the Nobel Prize in the science category since 1901. Which is when it was invented. So then all the biases are there. It's just that inside ISRO, they said that if your work is good, you'll get the opportunity. But because the explanation that they gave for the lack of numbers is that 30 years ago, like, you know, when they were just starting out, at that point, less women joined. So since less women joined, is today, ISRO follows a very hierarchical process. You can't jump, it's not a private company, you have to put in the years. So that is why enough number of people are not there in the top positions. But they said now, because there are more people joining, so maybe in about 10 years, 15 years, you can expect that you will have a woman as a chairperson of ISRO. That is their goal. And then also the biases came in, you know, in the things that they didn't realize that they were saying. Yeah, like I for the Mangalyaan project, I worked days and nights, and my in-laws were very supportive. They allowed me to come home late. You know, words like allowed, or even the support of your like say mother-in-law or something. You know, so that's fine. Actually, everybody needs support. So there's one person who said that my bosses used to say, just like we call for ground support, you also call your support system. Your mother-in-law comes all the way from Hyderabad to look after your children. But she's like, yeah, so that's a big deal. So these kind of words, they were not even conscious that they were saying. And
so,
it
so
showed
deeply embedded.
Deeply.
But do you think it's kind of sad, you know, in this era also, we have to underline, define,
yes,
talk about gender equality, fight for it.
Yes.
Are we still very far away from gender equality?
I would say we're closer than we were earlier. We are a lot closer than we were maybe even 20 years ago or 25 years ago when I started journalism. That time, yeah, in media, of course, there is no such thing. Media women are actually doing better than men.
Yes.
From the time that I joined, and today, and then hopefully it will continue. all, the men are trailing behind. But in science, in STEM, there has been a very obvious kind of a gap. There is a gap.
But then there is no glass ceiling as such.
No, there is no glass ceiling, but even if you say that NASA, for instance, also has 20% women, and for planetary missions, 15%. So how absurd is that? There is a very good quote from the astrophysicist Vera Rubin, which goes something like this: there is no problem in science that can be solved by a man that cannot be solved by a woman. Yeah, and really, that is, to me, that was the like the, you know, the most important thing. But the biases are very deeply ingrained, and somewhere, of course, you find, like Ritu Karidhal's husband, for instance, he said something so striking. Again, he said it, he didn't even realize that it was such a striking thing. He said, I get my identity through Ritu these days. I'm known as Ritu's husband. I thought that was such a good, such a wonderful thing that I wanted to hug him. He was so, you know, like he said it very matter-of-factly. Hum Lucknow jaate hai, or he's from, I think, Raipur or something. So I'm known as Ritu's husband.
Good for him.
Good for him, yeah. And he said, you know, usko to pata bhi nahi hai ghar mein kya kaise maan hai. In this whole Mangalyaan thing, I'm the one who, you know, kind of looked after the house, looked after the children. Of course, he had help. And then that gave her the wings to, you know, like really fly.
Many, many warm moments in the book. Would you like to read any one of it to the audience here today?
Yeah, sure.
Please do. Is it?
Change is on its way, even if it is a little slow, a little onerous, a little too little. Any lasting change will occur when the mindset of an entire generation changes. When scoffing boys who grow up to become chauvinistic men stop believing that science is not for girls, or that women treat their jobs as a hobby or stopgap before marriage and family. The next generation of intrepid young women searching for their own glory have some of the road laid out for them by ISRO's women scientists, which I hope applies for all the women scientists here. These scientists come from modest, conservative backgrounds, from small places like Sagar, Dehradun or Arialur, having studied in vernacular medium schools. Many of them overcame parental and societal opposition to follow their inner voice. Handling high-pressure assignments which call for pinpoint precision according to tightly planned schedules, these women have come up with out-of-the-box concepts at work while also supervising family duties. They have done this with a minimum of fuss and fanfare. The only hint at the gender imbalance faced by them lies in their unconscious use of expressions such as adjustment, working harder to balance roles, or painstakingly crediting their families and husbands for their understanding and support. Then this is one last paragraph. For every man who thinks that women are meant to primarily look after their families and tend to children, there is a Ritu Karidhal who works three shifts to launch interplanetary satellites while her husband looks after the home front. Or a Durga Darshini who takes just 2 days off to get married and flies back to complete a mission. For every boss who feels maternity leave will not allow a woman to take on rigorous tasks, there is a Durga Darshini, again, who goes directly from her office to the hospital for her child's delivery.
So these women in ISRO have proved that rocket science is also their own. They can just take it forward.
Absolutely.
Your
people are my target audience, specifically young girls wanting to do STEM, because the biggest way of countering gender biases or, you know, a glass ceiling is to say sky is not the limit, is to show the visible role models that if these people can do it, if a Balamati from a vernacular medium school and with a father who said, hey, you know, don't go anywhere, just stay here and, you know, we look after your children, plan out your whole life. If she can become a project director, if Ritu Karidhal from, again, Lucknow, a small place, not IIT, not fancy colleges, but if they can reach where they have reached, then, you know, you can. So don't give up on your dream. The biggest, one of the big learnings that I had from the book is another scientist, Sita Somasundaram, who told me that in science, you have to find a niche. Yeah? You have to do something which other people have not done before. And then having found that, you have to find the rigor to pursue it and not give up. which is really what the Mangalyaan mission and a lot of the other women in the other areas also did. You know, they didn't give up. They didn't give up. They stuck to it.
Very inspiring stories of these ISRO women. I'm sure all of you will be interested and read more about it. Thank you very much for that. Thank you.